graffiti has been around in all different parts of the world in one form or another, whether it was, you want to consider the cave paintings in Lascaux on down. People, by the time they had walls, they were writing on them. Early in the United States, beginning really in the antebellum years, people began to write on boxcars that would roll from coast to coast. In the hobo years of the Depression, that became even more prominent. There was always gang graffiti dating back to the 30s and 20s in Los Angeles and other parts of California, the Southwest. There was name-based graffiti all over the place. There was Kilroy was here, which actually sprung out of a suburb of Boston, oddly enough, and became this kind of global icon for the greatest generation. But when this odd combination of name and fame came together in the late 1960s in both Philadelphia and New York, it really exploded. And what was so magical and so important in the history of American graffiti were the years really 1971 to 1975 in New York. And what happened was a generation of kids, and it's really important to remember that, these were kids. There was almost nobody over the age of 19 involved in this, developed a whole art form that went from a simple signature, just Joe was here kind of thing, all the way up to a mural that covered the entire side of a subway car. And this was something that had just never been seen in our history before, an entire movement just completely developed by kids.
Graffiti can be many things.
The ephemeral lasts.
That's just so damn cute, isn't it?
From the scandalous scrawlings of Roman citizens to the radical graffiti of revolutionary Parisians. It can be scratched, written, even painted. But what does it mean?
For tens of thousands of years, humans have been leaving their marks on walls.
From caves to city streets, graffiti is something that seems to bubble up wherever humans go.
It's an explosion of creativity.
Graffiti surrounds us, but is it a blessing or is it a curse?
When does vandalism become graffiti? When does graffiti become street art? And when does street art just become, well, art?
In this film, I'll show how the best graffiti is shaping the world of art with its sheer vitality.
Graffiti is a state of mind. It's not a thing. It's not a product.
And that graffiti can be political and even help us to come to terms with the past.
It is really genuinely moving.
I'm Dr. Richard Clay, and this is my brief history of graffiti.
It's underground art history.
Posters and graffiti had become very dangerous indeed. As the 19th century progressed, increasingly powerful print technologies started to be put to work serving a very modern master. Advertising. Cities like New York, probably the most image-stuffed place on earth, saw the madmen of advertising plaster commercial imagery across every available blank space.
Lithography in the early 19th century changes everything. Suddenly, imagery becomes part of the vocabulary of commercial advertising. Images layered over images layered over images on the street. In the 20th century, we end up with posters that are the size of buildings, multi-story images. And in the late 20th century, this kind of circus, this republic of commercial signs that's all-encompassing, and yet still graffiti finds its place in the nooks and the crannies in this forest of symbols.
Cities changed. Walls became covered in advertising. As the 20th century rolled on and urban areas sprawled, some inhabitants of the city made their mark in the gaps between the ads. This new graffiti that hit the urban sprawl of 60s and 70s America created a moral panic. To those in power, it was symbolic of decay. For them, it was barbaric. It was vandalism. And it harnessed a new technology. The paint spray can, invented in 1949. This new kind of graffiti would eventually spread across the globe and energize the world of art.
You know what? We're kidding ourselves if we don't think that graffiti is implicitly, if not explicitly, political. Every blank wall tells us that this space is under control. This is why the authorities in New York City were so obsessed with the explosion of throw-ups and of tags that emerged in the 70s and in the 80s, with the birth of stencil art. It is political, but on the other hand, if somebody decides to tag the side of my house, I'm going to want to break their legs.
Born in Philadelphia in the 1960s, modern graffiti rapidly spread through the boroughs of New York City. The Big Apple of the 70s was near bankrupt. Crime rates soared and garbage filled the streets.
Writing, or graffiti as it is more commonly known, is a direct descendant of the most primitive artists dating back between 200,000 and 50,000 BC. In Western Europe, cave dwellers created wall paintings using a red and black pigment to depict various symbols and images encountered in their daily life. Over time, man's use of color and technique became more refined and sophisticated, but what has not changed is this inner desire to express himself visually.
The four elements of hip-hop, MC, graffiti, the dance element, what some people call breakdance, and the DJ, all of it to me goes back to Africa. You know, I always say this is Africa all the way. When I think of graffiti, I think of hieroglyphics, to be honest with you.
I looked at the work and I couldn't read a lot of it. So I understood that they were creating not only their own art, but their own language, their own hieroglyphic, their own symbolism. Just like Native Americans have symbols. Well, they had symbols, the arrows and, you know, little curves and It got denser and denser. It became like modern jazz, which was layered. It reflected to me an energy. Again, this was something that came from the streets.
During the late 60s, political activists used graffiti to write statements of protest and to express outrage to the masses. Street gangs also used graffiti to promote their name or mark their territory.
You had the gangs out there in the 70s and, you know, people wanted their recognition and people to acknowledge their turf by writing your name with a spray can, which was accessible, marked your turf.
But graffiti as we know it today was born out of the heart of Philadelphia. Two writers began tagging their names all over the city, Cool Earl and Cornbread.
Films like Cornbread Earl and Me was actually supposed to have been about a graffiti artist, and they turned it to a ball player, you know, that there was graffiti happening in places like Philadelphia in the 1960s.
Around the same time, Manhattan writers appeared on the scene. Taki 183 was the subject of a 1971 New York Times article due to his frequent tags around the city. Brooklyn artists also became active, and soon after, all five boroughs used the subway to raise self-awareness and spark a movement that would change the entire art world.
Graffiti was an all-city movement, and people said, well, if I paint my name over here, instead of painting it on the side of a building where it marked my territory, if you put it on the subway, it went all-city, right? It went from the Bronx to Brooklyn and back to the Bronx again, went all over through Manhattan, and people were like, damn, that means something really different. Now we're not talking about like one area.
I mean, one hour you could be uptown Bronx over here, and the next hour and a half you're sitting somewhere in Brooklyn. I mean, that's the best form of advertisement and free advertisement that you can ever get. you know, and that was very, very, very important to me.
I remember interviewing Lee Quinones during the time of the hip-hop exhibit last year, and he talking about as a young Puerto Rican boy coming up in New York City, being able to tag his name on subways and that being a moving canvas, around the city was so empowering because he felt like he was powerless, you know, to be able to say, I love you, Mom, giving shout-outs to his girlfriend when it was Lady Pink at the time, that kind of stuff was empowering.
Graffiti artists began a trend of self-motivation. They also used their art as a form of escape from horrible inner-city living conditions.
I grew up in the 75th precinct, and the 75th precinct for years had the highest murder rate in New York City. I grew up in the Pink Houses, which was the home of the most powerful gangs in Brooklyn. And we talk about the Tomahawks and the Pearl Hells.
Whenever people have been disempowered, you know, us as black people, as African people, as Latino people, as people of color especially, you know, what better way to empower yourself than to write your name somewhere? You know what I'm saying? I mean, you think back to when we were shorties in school, we carved our names into the desk. That was graffiti, not even realizing it. And I think, you know, obviously when it exploded in the New York City area in the 1970s, when people started saying, why is this stuff on the subways? You know, they're vandalizing, it's messed up. What they didn't realize is that they had the people who are the powers that be in the city, or the wealthy in the city, have basically separated themselves from this whole underground community.
Around the mid-70s, competition grew intense. Writers began to use different tag styles and symbols. They began to experiment with letter thickness and switch aerosol caps to achieve a greater width. This soon gave way to the masterpiece, or top to bottom.
Oh, I saw the first piece. It was super cool, 223. And he did this, well, what later would be called a masterpiece. But the day it happened, I went to school and I was trying to explain it to people, but I didn't have any words to say it, because there wasn't a word invented yet to describe what it was. And it was just that it was a bigger thing than, the letters were fat and they were filled in instead of just being a signature.
Other styles were introduced. Bubble letters, Broadway style, and block lettering proved to be the foundation of many styles. Although too many to name, some artists do stand out as notable pioneers.
Number one, Lee. Lee stood out. He was a pioneer where he took whole cars and he gave it a big scenery as opposed to just making an elaborate name and souping your name up, so to speak. He added scenery. Blade was big time. Blade and Comet, that was a good team.
Vulcan was just so beautiful. He looked like a Jimi Hendrix, man. His work was just like layered, man. His was like modern art, modern jazz.
Lady Pink, Lee Quinones, some of those pioneers, Tracy, Cal, Mayer, you know, Phase 2, those types of folks.
Phase 2 is the most important graffiti artist of all time, and the reason why is style. His standard back then, the standard that he set for the other writers was just so high, and the bar kept going up and up and up.
But I always looked at guys like Phase 2, who I feel like is the most important writer that there ever was. And he changed it, he changed the face of it, of writing.
Seen today is one of the world's most recognized living artists today. Now, living, and that's, you know, and I underline that a number of times, but we're talking about Picasso, Dali, all these guys in their heyday. This is what's seen as today.
Dondi White was well respected.
We had the great masters, like you guys are probably very well familiar with Dondi. Well, I was the one that taught Dondi how to write.
There was a brother in, in Brooklyn who used to do handball courts. Young brother, man, little skinny kid. He looked like he was about 13. His name was Gnome, G-N-O-M-E. And his stuff was flawless, man. He used to do castles in the sky type stuff.
You know, we talking about a guy like Dondi who had throw-ups. He was part of a whole car movement that also included a guy like Knock 167, whose fame was he did what is considered the most beautiful whole car in the world, which was the Star Wars whole car. Okay, and he rode with an organization that was just like Top, called CIA, which is also a member, is the sister organization of TOP, because that was the organization that was second generation Top, and they took it to levels that the first generation TOP members did not take it, and that was